tropical rainforests of Costa Rica. We're even going to take you underwater to our own beautiful coral reefs.
And there are a lot of them here. We've taken our Channel 4 cameras all over South Florida. We'll show you how your neighbors celebrated Earth Day. And we'll visit with the Keys' favorite conch, Jimmy Buffett.
But right now, let's go to Key Biscayne and Channel 4's Susan Lichtman and Nick Bogue.
Easy to appreciate the environment, and today there is lots to celebrate.
On the other hand, there's lots of reason for concern as well, Susan, because there's been some bad news as well as good since 1970 and the very first Earth Day.
That's right. That's back when America's interest in the environment, her concern for the environment, was just blooming.
If not now,
the now was April 22nd, 1970, Earth Day. More than 20 million people nationwide rallied to take stock in the environment. It was a huge grassroots demonstration aimed at sensitizing America's psyche to the fragile nature of life on the planet. It worked. America was touched. Earth Day gave birth to the environmental movement. And move we did. In the wake of Earth Day, the federal government created the Environmental Protection Agency. Congress passed the Clean Air Act, the Clean Water Act, the Toxic Substances Control Act, the National Forest Management Act. Activists forced the military to stop spraying Agent Orange in the jungles of Vietnam. And 12 anti-environmental congressmen were tarred as the Dirty Dozen. Seven were voted out of office. There have been great environmental success stories. Cars are 85% cleaner than they were in 1970 because of catalytic converters and unleaded gas. Electrical utilities have spent $100 billion to produce cleaner energy. Sulfur dioxide emissions reduced by 22%. Power plants burning cleaner coal. Recycling plastics, paper, and aluminum is reducing our mountains of solid waste. But there have also been catastrophic problems. Toxic chemicals seeping into our food, our water, our land.
Are you going to monitor those people and watch those babies die?
A former resident of Love Canal, the most notorious toxic waste site in the country. For years, some 800 families unknowingly lived on top of a 22,000-ton toxic waste dump. Until 1978, when the poisons bubbled up into their backyards, their basements, their bathrooms. Love Canal was declared uninhabitable. It's now a ghost town, and so too many of its former residents.
The woman lived in that house had cancer. The man that lived in that house a few years back, he died with cancer. There's something wrong.
There's a lot wrong with the way we treat the environment. Or have you forgotten the 1980s, the decade of conspicuous consumption? Or have you forgotten the victims of Three Mile Island, Chernobyl, the Exxon Valdez? And the events that don't make headlines day after day. Freighters that ram into our coral reefs, destroying acres of underwater marine life. Toxic chemicals from nearby agriculture, polluting Everglades National Park. Thoughtless people who consider the coastline one big trash can, spewing garbage and medical waste into the water. High levels of mercury in our fish. The killing of the manatee, the key deer, and the Florida panther. Murky rivers that hide hazardous chemicals and human waste. And now a new set of global problems is unfolding.
We're killing our planet. Oil spills, ocean pollution, vanishing rainforests, a hole in the ozone layer.
The idea is to think globally and act locally. It's an idea that's catching on from politicians.
And I again reject the extremists in the environmental movement who would burden our economy by mindless regulation. And I reject those who do not recognize their obligations to clean up our environment.
To celebrities.
We have an opportunity to slow down this global climate crisis and to learn how to live together on this planet rather than ravaging.
And no message could have been any clearer. If you want to make the world a better place, take a look at yourself and make a change.
Making the change is easy. It's as simple as cleaning up your favorite beach, recycling your old soda cans and newspapers, using biodegradable paper products instead of plastic, carpooling to work, even planting a tree in your own backyard. Because the environmental problems we face today are caused by man. We have met the enemy, and he is us. And we're the only ones who can turn things around.
What we have to do is to have cars that get 35, 40, 45 miles per gallon. We have to start using air conditioners that don't have chlorofluorocarbons in them that destroy the ozone layer. But there are other ways to keep ourselves comfortable. People are going to have to change their lifestyles, but I think if the alternative is the destruction of the world, we're ready to do that.
If we're not ready to do that, if we continue to rape the planet to nourish our greed, the Earth will turn on us and become our hostile neighbor. If we pollute the planet, we become a willing partner in our own demise.
And the changes are still coming. The Environmental Protection Agency is about to be given cabinet-level status, and there's a new clean air bill on Capitol Hill. It's 13 years in the making. It's designed to cut acid rain by 50% and reduce cancer-causing pollutants and smog. It's a historic bill that has the potential to affect future generations.
But really, the idea behind Earth Day 1990, Susan, is not to let government do it all. We can each do quite a bit ourselves, at home, at work, in our cars, and as we shop.
That's right. During the next half hour, we're going to give you all kinds of names of places and people to call to help solve your environmental problems. So we suggest that you get a pencil and a paper handy.
That would be a pencil and a recycled piece of paper. There's really no way of knowing how many people across the globe have taken part in Earth Day 1990, but we do know that quite a few of them were South Floridians. They had a ball in Miami's Bayfront Park. In Davie, they were getting arty about Earth Day. The folks were singing in Miami shores.
So the manatee.
And planting in Olita River Park in North Dade. All over South Florida, they were celebrating the environment and getting the hint of good news to come early today as President Bush, presenting a plaque to the group Reef Relief, said he'd talked with that group's leader about offshore oil drilling around the Keys.
I told him there would be an answer very, very soon, and I didn't think he'd be too disappointed.
Earth Day's answers for many folks were about making South Florida greener.
Global Relief is a part of a nationwide campaign to plant 100 million trees in the next several years.
In Miami, Dick Clark helped dig in and plant for Earth Day and said he'd caught on to recycling.
At our office, I said, let's get rid of the plastic cups and go to the paper disposable.
Earth Day inspired some creative efforts, encouraging the art of recycling.
The New York Times produces 8 million pounds of newspaper every Sunday.
Christopher Shuckneck was helping his mom make a garbage flag to make a point about pollution. And he was following the Earth Day motto about acting locally while thinking globally.
In Germany, there's pollution all over, and a lot of people died from it.
Plenty of Christopher's contemporaries were into Earth Day. Kids from Bay Harbor Elementary were planting the tomato seeds that had been aloft in the shuttle. And they did a little Enviro rap, too. And Miami Shores Earth Day birthday was raising money for the children's rainforest and was at least in part a kid's idea. The group sponsoring it, Pals of Wildlife, was founded a couple of years ago by Lyle Sala Yates, who was then just six.
I thought it would just stay like a little club, not a big, humongous thing.
The ultimate aim is to make Earth Day less special and less of a phenomenon. The goal is to make everyday Earth Day.
By some estimates, we lose 24 plant or animal species every day. That's one an hour. It is not a good sign, considering these species might be our best barometer for measuring the health of our environment.
Florida's environment is unique, but much of what makes this place special is disappearing. There are fewer than 50 Florida panthers left, less than 20 female breeding crocodiles in all of North America. Wood storks have trouble breeding because we've interrupted the natural water flow, and manatees fall victim to boat propellers. There are 34 endangered species in Florida, 635 in all of the world, and you can find dozens of them at Dade's Metro Zoo. The Saimang is an endangered ape, so are gorillas and chimpanzees. The white tiger is endangered, as is the black rhinoceros. Some say the health of a species is a good barometer of the health of our environment.
You have to realize that though an animal may die, that animal may be the principal food for another animal. That, in fact, may be the principal food for another animal, and you have an effect, a domino effect that occurs. So by one animal dying, it could really result in the disappearance of a wide variety of living things.
There's an ecology theater at the zoo, and even very young children seem to understand the importance of protecting endangered animals.
They're living things, and that doesn't have the right for people to kill them.
Why do you want to save endangered animals?
Well, because they have a right to live, they're living things, and we should, like, protect our rights.
What's your favorite animal?
An elephant.
An elephant?
Yep.
What if I told you that these elephants over here, there weren't very many of them left, and they might all be gone someday?
I would cry.
Erin might be too young to understand. Her favorite animal is endangered. The African elephant is being killed off for its ivory tusks. But in Florida, endangered animals aren't threatened by hunters. We're simply crowding them out. Experts call it habitat destruction. The threat of extinction grows as their domain shrinks. Our cars have claimed 1/6 of the key deer population. This baby deer is being nursed at Metro Zoo after a car shattered its leg. Jackie Shaw surgically fixed the leg by implanting metal rods, but it will never be as good as new. We are killing this endangered animal with kindness. Feeding them in the wild is illegal.
This really is bad because then, you know, they have no fear of people and they don't know about cars and they'll run across the road to go and get fed and I guess people feed them in their backyards and really this is not, we should really keep them in a refuge and away from people if we want to keep the species going.
Governing and restricting growth, setting aside lands for wildlife is the ideal solution, but development sometimes makes that unrealistic. Man and animals will have to learn to coexist. For that, we need education. And what better way to educate your children than a trip to the zoo?
You know, the lions and tigers and bears, on my theory, thrown out the door because they see lions and tigers and bears out here in their natural environment, in a more of a natural way. So they're not threatened by the animals. On the contrary, they seem to become attached to the animals. And they tend to follow that cause. Let's protect these animals. I can't imagine that we would take, you know, the skin off their back to put it on our backs. They need it more than we do. We try to educate them in that point.
Now, if you've got some spare time and you'd like to use it as a volunteer to help endangered animals, here are those telephone numbers that we promised you at the beginning of the show. If you'd like to help Florida Key Deer, the telephone number is 1-872-3725. For manatees, the telephone is 1-800-432-6646. And finally, 1-800-5-FLA-CAT, and that's for the endangered Florida panther.
One of the best ways to ensure the survival of endangered species is to buy land and set it aside for them. Several groups have long track records of doing just that. Among them, the Florida Keys Land and Sea Trust at 1-743-3900 and the Nature Conservancy at 407-628-5887.
Did you know that it takes a 500,000 trees to supply us with our Sunday newspapers? Recycle your newspapers, aluminum, glass, and motor oil.
It's a matter of life. It's a matter of pride.
Munch? The grimy stuff on the glass of my microwave door.
Muckmire! The dirt that streaks across my windows.
Fur?
That icky stuff that sticks to my mirror.
Whatever you call it, now you can get rid of it. Because one of the oldest names for cleaning power is the newest name for cleaning glass. Introducing SOS Extra Strength Glass Cleaner. So for all the smirt and smud and furf that creep into your life, get the power of SOS Glass Cleaner. For any kind of mess, call SOS.
Hey, what was that?
Sounded like a wolf.
You mean like a big bad wolf?
Come on, Kermit. Wolves aren't bad, they're just predators.
What?
Any animal that hunts and eats another animal is a predator.
Ooh.
Wolves, bears, owls, even spiders are predators. Hmm. Of course, you may not want to have them over for a marshmallow, but They're all part of nature. Even frogs are predators.
Oh, yeah, I see what you mean.
But predators are in trouble because of poaching and shrinking habitat.
Gee, what can we do to help?
Well, if you'd like to learn more about predators and how to help them, write Predators, National Wildlife Federation, Washington, D.C., 20036.
Great! Now what's for supper?
Don't look at us.
Oh, no.
Environmentally conscious consumers buy pump sprays instead of aerosol, bar soaps instead of liquid soap, wax paper instead of plastic wrap, and cloth instead of paper towel.
They may be the planet's best protection against man's worst pollution, tropical forests. We went to Costa Rica's forests, both dry coastal woods along the Pacific coast and the magnificent cloud forest high in the mountains of Monteverde, with a group of Dade County teachers who know the value of a good forest when they see it.
Hundreds of thousands of people benefit from the drugs and chemicals that have been made. That's just one aspect of the rainforest.
But all over the globe, tropical forests are coming down, and we don't really know what we're missing. So few of the plants and animals here have been studied that one scientist likened the destruction of the rainforests to burning down the library when you've only read a few of the books. But some reasons to hope these forests can be saved are obvious. Channel 4 photographer Jeff Guerra found them everywhere.
The wilderness vanishes, so do we.
Spectacular pictures of a spectacular place, the tropical forests of Costa Rica, taken by photographer Jeff Guerra. You and Jeff just came back from there.
We did. We went down with a group of Dade County school teachers, and starting on Tuesday, we will have a special series on the disappearance of the rainforests, how that relates to the problems of global warming, how we might be missing opportunities to cure cancer, AIDS, and other diseases.
why it's all happening and some things people can do to stop it.
Next series, Rainforest, Trouble in the Tropics, begins Tuesday at 5:30 on the Channel 4 News. You know, according to the Environmental Defense Fund, all of our rainforests could be virtually destroyed by the year 2032. That's not very far away, and that poses a major threat to the planet.
If you're interested in some tips on how we might stem the greenhouse effect, the global warming effect, you can call EDF at 1-800-523-2929. Ask for their free pamphlet, Global Warming and Ozone Depletion. Those are very complex issues, Susan. Scientists really are still grappling with understanding them.
One thing is very clear, though. In the words of one researcher, we are insulting the planet faster than we're understanding it. In fact, there's a classic case of that right here in South Florida.
Mother Nature's fury, South Florida style. When people began to settle this tropical paradise at the turn of the century, they cleared the forests, fought mosquitoes, and coped with flooding brought by one monster storm after another. After several deadly floods, we built what amounts to a giant plumbing system for the southern part of the state. We're still paying the environmental price for that.
The most visible signs of water management are the many flood control canals which crisscross South Florida, especially here on the coast. But the system itself begins deep in central Florida with the Kissimmee River.
As recently as 1938, Florida's water machine was very different from today. Water fell in the Kissimmee Basin, working its way into Lake Okeechobee via the meandering Kissimmee. Leaving the lake, the water entered a vast freshwater marsh covering much of Palm Beach, Broward, and Dade counties. Then the Army Corps of Engineers channelized the Kissimmee, providing drainage for agricultural areas and pouring pollution from dairy farms into the lake. Meanwhile, runoff from sugarcane fields was being pumped into Lake Okeechobee, creating a 1-2 punch that nearly killed it. Now, back pumping has been stopped, but sugar field runoff may threaten the Everglades as it flows south. Lawmakers are weighing a plan to tax big sugar companies heavily to pay to clean it up. Meanwhile, incredible development south of the lake has destroyed a lot of marshland, compressing the area over which the water can flow southward, often flooding sensitive bird nesting areas.
When that amount of water is released in a restricted part of the flow section, all nests downstream are flooded out.
So our man-made plumbing system has produced problems of water quantity and quality and made the Everglades one of our most threatened national parks. There are plans to put the bends back in the Kissimmee and otherwise rework the plumbing system from top to bottom. They'll cost millions, maybe billions. But can we afford not to pay?
80% of our water rainfall comes from the wet Everglades, so we've got to keep it wet or we'd be a desert and nobody would be able to live here.
Those water problems could well be South Florida's biggest environmental dilemma. We talked to almost 100 local Earth Day organizers, and they agreed. Problems associated with water quality and water quantity top the list, followed by restoring the Everglades. Then getting a handle on our garbage problems and growth management.
But no matter whose poll you cite, the Keys' favorite conch is coming up next. Jimmy Buffett, always totally in tune with Earth Day.
Save water in your bathroom. Repair leaky faucets and toilets. Save water by placing an open mason jar in the toilet tank. Even replace shower heads with a low flow kind.
It's a matter of pride.
Eastern's Anywhere Fares. Fares to take you anywhere we fly in the USA for only $79 to $189 to cities like New York, San Francisco, Washington, D.C., Atlanta, Chicago, Los Angeles. Anywhere in the USA, only $79 to $189 now through June 27th. Only on Eastern. Fares that will make you fly.
Turn it off! Mandatory water restrictions are now in effect for Palm Beach, Broward, Dade, and Monroe counties. Lawn watering, car washing, and boat rinsing are restricted. Obvious wasting of water is prohibited. Serious fines could result. Call 1-800-662-TURN for details.
Turn it off!
Water's the lifeblood of South Florida. Don't bleed us dry.
Turn it off!
If you want your news clear and focused, if you want to see journalists in action who are really excited about their work. This is the place to be. We don't feel that we have to be sensational, that we have to hone in on the crime problem that everybody knows exists here. We just want to give the real news, the clear and focused news of the day.
Buy rechargeable batteries. Dumping old ones can contribute to hazardous waste. Recycle your car's oil. Pouring a quart of oil on the ground can contaminate 250,000 gallons of drinking water.
Worshiping the sun on the corner of walking, don't walk somewhere down US 1. Back to living Florida, blue skies and ultraviolet rays. We're hoping for a better day, hoping for a better day. Back to living Florida, blue skies and ultraviolet rays. Looking for a better day.
It's good in a way that we take time to celebrate Earth Day, but I think every day should be an Earth Day. People spend an enormous amount of time devoting to other things that hurt the Earth, so maybe by starting with one day a year, we can start people on the road to practicing Earth Day 365 days a year. Well, there's nothing more important. If you figure that by the start of the 21st century, which I hope to be around for that party, we could probably destroy ourselves with the chemicals and the toxins we put into the air without ever firing a shot in a cold war or a hot war. So that needs to change drastically. I'm always an optimist, so things look a little bit optimistic. I think if we can get to the next generation of children, we'll be okay. All right. Well done. That's see? Got to clean up this environment.
America is in over its head. In trash, that is. We're piling it up, this mountain of garbage. Half a million tons of it every 24 hours.
American society is very wasteful, the most wasteful society in history.
Landfills do get filled, and new ones are hard to locate, very expensive to build, and hard to keep environmentally safe.
In landfills, when it rains, the water seeps through and pulls out toxics that can get into our drinking water.
Most of South Florida's major landfills are leaking pollutants. Several are on the federal Superfund list of the country's worst pollution sites. We'll always need some place to put our garbage, but we can lessen landfills' impacts by using the three R's.
The three R's are reduce the amount of solid waste that we produce, reuse the waste whenever we can, and only then recycle.
A lot of us are beginning to recycle. Curbside programs are popping up in almost every South Florida city. And there's a lot of recycling going on in industrial settings that we never see.
This was a car at one time that went through the shredder. There's a lot of metal out there that's coming in here being shredded and sent back to the steel mills for reprocessing to make next year's appliances, cars, or whatever it may be.
But as environmentally sound as recycling is, pre-cycling is even better.
We go to buy some soup at the store, and it comes with this plastic bowl, and it comes with all this plastic wrapping, and then an extra cardboard box. Why do we need that?
Pre-cycling means not buying what Crow's group calls waste maker winners.
Do you know how much of the solid waste we generate in South Florida is actually made up of ordinary yard waste, like grass clippings or branches? 30%. Do you know how you can reuse and recycle that?
Ask 14-year-old Lisa Parker, who won first place for her school science project on composting. She mixed wood chips and branches with yard and food waste.
We just throw it places when you can just make it into a soil instead of going out and buying fertilizer and stuff.
Lisa says it's just a matter of common sense. Others say it's a matter of great importance.
a matter of saving our earth, saving South Florida. If we can get many, many people beginning to reduce our impact on the earth through our use of materials and paper, then we will lessen that impact and we will all have a better planet for it.
Some recycling pays. Take aluminum and this reverse vending machine in Northwest Miami. Cans are fed in and crushed. Money is spit out to the tune of 25 cents a pound. It's recycling that makes economic sense to all sides.
We resell it to the Anheuser-Busch company and we get 50 cents a pound. So there's money in it for us, there's money in it for the consumer, and that's the most important factor.
It's a big reason why about 60% of all aluminum cans are recycled, compared to only 20% for glass products and just 1% for plastic goods, though plastic recycling's just in its infancy.
But the big loser in the economics of recycling is paper, particularly newspaper. The bottom's dropped out of the market.
There's a lot of supply, so many cities have begun curbside recycling. But there's not so much demand. Too few plants like this one the Herald co-owns in Georgia that turn old newspapers into new paper stock. There's a two-year backlog of paper waiting to be recycled. Recycling won't make real sense until it makes dollars and cents. And that means overcoming some consumer resistance.
When you go to the store, think recycling before you buy. So buy materials that are going to be recyclable. Buy materials that are not excessively packaged.
Local governments in Florida will be required to buy more recycled paper over the next several years. Some think the federal government, the country's single biggest paper user, has been a little slow to buy recycled. But recycling doesn't have to make money to make sense. It just has to be cheaper than the cost of disposal. That's $27 to $36 a ton at Dade's landfills, $38 a ton in Broward. And at a business that produces a lot of expensive to get rid of hazardous wastes, like the solvents at Miami's Bertram Yacht, recycling saves. This machine turns solvents into fuel.
This is going to a company who uses that in the fuel blending process, and it's used in cement plants where, as a fuel.
But for most consumers, buying power, not fancy machines, will be the best weapon for making recycling an economic success.
All over South Florida, new landfills are a tough sell and cost a lot to build. Our biggest problems are in our smallest county.
Just last week, the Keys signed a contract to have Monroe County's trash hauled to a Broward dump. Monroe County is out of landfill space.
Now, if you'd like some more information about recycling, in Dade County, call 592-1776. And in Broward, 978-1160.
Coming up next, we're going to look at both sides of the pesticides issue. Consumers more and more are resisting them. Farmers say they can't get along without them.
Be an environmental shopper. Avoid disposable products like razors, napkins, and cutlery. And always buy paper instead of plastic or styrofoam.
It's a matter of pride.
Munch? The grimy stuff on the glass of my microwave door.
Muckmire! The dirt that streaks across my windows.
Fur?
That icky stuff that sticks to my mirror.
Whatever you call it, now you can get rid of it. Because one of the oldest names for cleaning power is the newest name for cleaning glass. Introducing SOS Extra Strength Glass Cleaner. So for all the smirt and smut and furf that creep into your life, get the power of SOS Glass Cleaner. For any kind of mess, call SOS.
Set foot on the Cayman Islands, we were relaxed vacationers, not tourists.
Cayman Airways, the most non-stops to the Cayman Islands. Boaters, here are a few environmental tips for your next outing from Channel 4. Before you drop anchor, make sure you're not over a reef. Let's preserve our precious treasures. Never throw your trash overboard. Use a litter bag and dispose of it when you return to the marina. Help keep our waters clean. And when you're done fishing, don't discard your fishing lines into the water. They can get entangled in floating plants that manatees eat. Help save our manatees.
Save South Florida. It's a matter of pride.
reduce junk mail. It's not only a nuisance, but an environmental problem. Write to Direct Marketing Association, P.O. Box 3861, New York, New York, 10163.
Depend on pesticides to kill harmful insects. Agricultural scientists say pesticides are an absolute necessity.
I think at our current level of technology, it'd be extremely difficult to get by with no pesticides at all. They're an important tool, and if used properly, they're perfectly safe as well.
The key to avoiding environmental damage, say the experts, is using pesticides properly. Citrus is Florida's biggest cash crop. Billions of oranges and grapefruits roll down the production chutes. Orange growers use pesticides to kill caterpillars, mites, and fire ants in their fields, but they don't use as much as they used to. The trend among vegetable and fruit growers in Florida is to use fewer pesticides. Now, there are a couple of reasons for this. Pesticides are expensive, and more, the public is demanding fruit that hasn't been sprayed. So what's the difference between a sprayed orange and a so-called organic one?
There's really no difference on the interior at all.
Just cosmetic.
They both look identical. It's all in the skin. It's all cosmetic. You can see the skin and you can see the fruit. It's identical on the inside, and there's a few blemishes on the organic piece of fruit on the outside.
Produce dealers say the demand for organic fruits and vegetables has never been higher, even though organics often cost twice as much. It seems people are willing to pay more for better taste.
As opposed to a lot of the commercial stuff being brought through now that really is, besides being tasteless, filled with waxes and pesticides.
The experts say those pesticides are safe, but many people don't want to take chances. And with more farmers joining the organic camp, they may not have to.
If you'd like to see more organically grown produce on your market shelves, tell the manager. Better yet, put your feelings in writing.
That's right. If you want more information on pesticides, you can contact the Natural Resources Defense Council, 40 West 20th Street, New York, New York, 10011.
You know, our kids are writing and reading a lot more about their planet these days because the environment's as hot a topic in school as it is anywhere else.
That's right. In South Florida, students are learning they can make a difference even in tackling the big ecological issues.
There's a big, beautiful planet in the sky. It's my home. It's where I live.
A new generation of trailblazers are appearing all over South Florida, kids doing what needs to be done to reverse the deterioration of our planet. They are all moving right in step with the rhythm pulsating worldwide, summoning all of us to take urgent, responsible action. Throughout South Florida schools, kids are being told and shown they can accomplish wonderful things for the Earth. And students are taking that knowledge and turning out some powerfully creative messages.
I thought of how I hate it in the city where the only plants that you see are in between the sidewalk cracks, and that's all you see, and besides that, what is there? So I thought maybe I'll show that with how the businessman's greed just completely destroyed everything.
17-year-old Claudette Barjoud took first place honors in the Dade School System's first environment film contest with her computer animated project. She and about 40 other high school students had their videotapes and public service announcements showcased in a festival coordinated by Sunset High teacher Steve Frank.
I feel as though we talk so much about this being the future generation, it sounds trite, but I feel as though they are now participating in what they're going to live in. They feel part of it.
Environment campaigns like this video contest show that South Florida school kids are not only willing but eager to do their part to save the Earth. It's up to parents and teachers to provide information, encouragement, and perhaps most important of all, to instill in kids a sense that they do have the power to make a difference.
It makes a difference in the world. We're just a bunch of students, but it feels so good to make a difference in the adult world as well as within school.
Fifth grader Oren Mischel made a difference at Cypress Elementary School in Kendall when his Earth Day poster won first place in a school-wide environmental awareness contest. Oren says the award gave him confidence he could help change and save the world.
Because later in our future, if we know all this information, we might be able to tell our children, and our children will tell everybody else that they know, and then people will realize it, and they'll start doing something about it.
South Florida school kids are learning they have a lot of power and that there are plenty of things they can do to protect our planet while experiencing the satisfaction that goes with doing something right and good.
Perhaps you feel inspired by all of that creative, youthful energy. Well, you can work on getting an environmental project started in your own school.
And in fact, we have some numbers for you if you're interested. The science department of the Dade County Schools is at 995-1989. And Broward Schools can be reached at 765-6274.
Use cloth diapers instead of disposable ones, even the biodegradable kind. They take 500 years to decompose. Cloth diapers take 1 to 6 months.
It's a matter of pride.
Did you know you could be losing business and not even know it?
Want a new robe?
No.
Which one do you want, fancy or plain?
Neither.
Pick one.
The one on the right.
Good choice.
It could depend on the 800 service your business is using. If you don't have AT&T 800 service, it takes over 40% longer for your customers' 800 calls to connect.
It's not even ringing.
And that could mean your customers are more likely to hang up.
The other one was you anyway.
And maybe call someone else. And that can be the difference between losing business...
Hi.
...and big business.
Yes, the robes. Hmm. Velvet collar? We'll take two.
800 Performance, another AT&T advantage. Order AT&T 800 service now and get free installation. After 6 months, if your 800 number isn't everything you expected, disconnect it and we'll pay 1 month's bill. Free installation? Satisfaction guaranteed. Two more AT&T advantages. Call 1-800-222-0400.
The Earth. Nature's gift. It's there for you to use to do something healthy. To keep yourself in balance. And there's always Evian natural spring water from the French Alps. Another of nature's gifts you can use to do something healthy.
Meet Channel 4's team behind the scenes.
I'm a videotape editor, so that's what I do.
The photographers go out and do their thing, the reporters do their thing.
We put it together,
get it on.
Someone's gonna come crashing through the door with that tape.
You have 3 minutes and 31 seconds to get your story there.
Gotta show them the real pictures to match the words.
Trying to beat the clock.
It's really a team effort.
There's a big rush.
Trying to get the story fast.
The anchors are ready to go.
Time won't stop.
The show is ready to go.
Getting it on and getting it right.
Get the story in on time.
When you do that, it feels good.
Underinflated tires waste 2 billion gallons of gas each year. Check them regularly. A glass bottle carelessly discarded lasts 3,000 years.
Beneath the waters off the Florida coast, you find a home for nature's gems. Dozens of species of living coral that together make up the only living reef in the United States. But take a closer look. That coral is now showing the scars of man, smashed by a freighter that strayed off course, chipped by a careless diver, or an anchor tossed off a small boat.
Sir, you gotta be more careful. You almost ran aground.
Environmentalists fear the living reef may not be living much longer.
Many people are well-meaning, but don't realize that the corals are live animals, and then when they touch them and step on them or throw their anchoring on them, they're killing the little animals that are making the reefs.
It takes those little animals another 100 years to regenerate. Biologists have found a way to repair coral, literally to cement it back together. But they say it's unrealistic to think we can just patch the reefs after we're done with them. So maybe we'll just have to better protect them. Right now, there's a bill in Congress and one in the Senate that would make the coral reefs off limits to most of the people who make their living here.
I think it's a bunch of baloney to pass a law to protect the coral. What we need is a law to protect the people, and the people are more important than the coral.
Reef specialists say one of the biggest threats to the coral is ignorance.
So please, don't touch the coral. Especially, please, don't stand on the coral.
Reef experts say the dive boat soft sell is simply not working.
I think we're going to have to, you know, grit our teeth a bit and tell them a little stronger way that this is not acceptable behavior in the water.
Scientists find this hairy growth on the reefs off Key Largo, and they worry. It's algae, and it too is snuffing out the coral. They suspect it's growing because the keys are growing, that pollutants from new septic systems aid algae growth. That may be a serious long-term threat, but in the short term, environmentalists suggest you take care of our reefs, and that if you're among them, leave them as you find them.
If you've got some extra time and energy that you'd like to devote to saving Florida's coral reefs, call an organization in the Keys called Reef Relief. You can reach them at 1-800-294-3100.
Or you can call the American Littoral Society at 361-4495 in Dade.
Save energy the easy way. Turn up your thermostat 1 degree for every hour you'll be away. And of course, turn all lights off when not in use.
It's a matter of pride.
Munch? The grimy stuff on the glass of my microwave door.
Muckmire!
The dirt that streaks across my windows.
Fur?
That icky stuff that sticks to my mirror.
Whatever you call it, now you can get rid of it. Because one of the oldest names for cleaning power is the newest name for cleaning glass. Introducing SOS Extra Strength Glass Cleaner. So for all the smirt and smud and furf that creep into your life, get the power of SOS Glass Cleaner. For any kind of mess, call SOS.
Whether it was built here or overseas, whether it's a car, truck, or van, from brakes to suspension to the very tailpipe of your car, nobody can touch us.
We're carrying the most complete line of mufflers.
For the latest in front-end technology.
Right, trained brake experts who do the job right and right away.
For a guarantee that's good all over the country.
For value and price.
And for putting more smiles on more customers' faces, nobody beats Midas.
Nobody.
If we each save one life, if we each change one heart, if we all take the time and we all do our part, we can save South Florida, we can turn back the tide. It's a matter of life, it's a matter of pride. Save one life, if we each change one heart, if we all take the time and we all do our part, we can save South Florida, we can turn back the tide. It's a matter of life, it's a matter of pride.
Celebrate Earth Day 1990. Do your part to protect the environment.
It's a matter of pride.
Reduce waste in your office. Use cloth typewriter ribbon instead of disposable ones. Metal tape dispensers instead of plastic. And use ceramic mugs instead of disposables.
Over the next 5 years, 1,500 homes will go up on this now mostly vacant land just west of I-75. That'll mean 5,000 new residents of Pembroke Pines, a city expected to double in population within 10 years.
Well, sometimes it is overwhelming, a bit overwhelming, to see all the growth and development of the community. But if it's done properly and correctly, it can be handled.
As sod replaces sawgrass and six-digit homes push alligators ever further west, South Florida cities walk a tightrope between growth and conservation, because all those sprawling subdivisions may well be killing our water supply.
You know, I don't think it's our job to stop development, but we can certainly encourage and sort of direct people as to how they can still do what they want to do, but they don't have to knock down all the trees to do it.
Florida hopes to curb rampaging development with a new system called concurrency. Essentially, what it means is that before new residents move in, the roads, sewers, and water delivery systems have to be in place. In a few parts of Monroe County, the state's already put a stop to building because road systems aren't ready to handle new growth. Developers, like the man putting up those 1,500 homes in Pembroke Pines, say concurrency costs money. The home buyer will pay for it.
But I think it'll slow things down for a while. I think it's going to make the developer think a little bit more carefully about what he's going to do. I think the cities right now will be very careful on what they approve, and the county will probably be very careful on what they're going to approve. But I think in the long run, I think it'll work out to everybody's advantage, because ultimately we're all here to satisfy the home buyer.
The new regulations took effect just last October, so concurrency's success is still in doubt. But it's the current rage among planners and environmentalists who hope it's the answer to the decades-long tug of war between land and man.
Although state rules establish most of the outer limits for growth, local county commissioners are the ones who have the most clout and say-so over what gets built and where. Lawyers and developers and lobbyists present very persuasive cases for growth, but the average citizen can put a stop to unwanted projects by going to county commission meetings, making their votes and voices heard.
You know, sooner or later, most of these issues we have been talking about will end up in the political arena. So it's important that you know who you are voting for and where they stand on environmental issues.
A group that can help you find that out is the League of Conservation Voters. You can reach them in Washington at 202-785-8683. And you can also check with local environmental organizations and find out their recommendations for candidates in state and local races.
Now, let's check in one more time with Susan and Nick in Dade. Happy Earth Day, guys.
Thanks, Steve. We have saved a most unusual Earth Day eco-adventure for last. The story of the good ship Globismo. A creative conglomeration of what most people would call garbage.
Fair to say, an unusual craft put together by a group of idealists down in Key West, captained by a couple of brothers who see themselves as the Christopher Columbuses of recycling and think that they may head us toward a new world of environmental harmony.
This is all rescued from Mother Nature.
The rescued rope and nets and bottles for flotation and tires have been coming together for months in Key West.
9 months of sweating, groaning, making love to automobile tires.
It was great.
Klaus Weiland and brother Chris hope their craft is destined for greatness, starting on Earth Day. They plan to whistle-stop the Florida coast, delivering a recycling message for months before taking off on a transatlantic voyage. Chris says both sides of the Atlantic need to heed the Globismo's anti-waste credo.
I thought a great medium to do this would be create an eco-adventure.
Thus far, five others have signed on for the Atlantic crossing, and the Weiland brothers' dream has gotten help from the kids at Poinciana Elementary. They collected a lot of bottles and rope this year, and now they're rooting for safe passage.
I would like to see if the stuff we brought in really floats and if it can really make it across.
It would be a crazy idea to make a raft out of all that stuff.
I just hope it makes it across.
Would you like to go along?
Yeah.
Would you?
Yeah. There is no such thing as waste.
The Weilands, German-born, raised in England, miss no chance to spread the word. And the Globismo gets a lot of curious visitors dockside.
I don't know. What is it?
What the Weilands hope it is an icon to ecology. And though some might find their goal far-fetched, even risky, the Weilands aren't worried.
I'm a very cautious person.
It won't sink.
Well, obviously, there are all kinds of ways to try to make a difference on this Earth Day, and that's really the message we want to leave you with as we end our Matter of Pride Earth Day special.
We hope we've shed some light on the environmental issues facing all of us, and that in your own way, you will help protect the natural resources of South Florida and the world, because it is a wonderful world.
I see trees of green, red roses too. I see them bloom for me and you. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. I see skies of blue. Bright, blessed day, the dark, sacred night, and I think to myself, what a wonderful world. The colors of the rainbow, so pretty in the sky, are also on the faces of people going by. I see friends shaking hands, saying, how do you do? They're really saying, I love you. to myself, what a wonderful world. Yes, I think to myself,